First, however, we went to the RAF airfield at Brize Norton in Oxfordshire, where the Concorde pilots are trained. There I met Chief Training Officer Captain Norman Todd, who was the pilot on Concorde's inaugural flight to Washington.
It's a magnificent looking machine, isn't it?
There's no
doubt
about it. Really beautiful.
What surprises me was that, now, I felt the ground vibrating. I definitely felt that all right. But the sound, the noise wasn't as great as I thought it would be.
Well, you're standing very close to where the aeroplane touched down, which you would never normally be doing. But the noise really isn't that bad. Mm. A lot of nonsense is spoken about the noise.
Right.
As you can see for yourself, it was quite acceptable.
Right. What speed was he doing coming in there?
He'd be touching down about 117 miles an hour.
I'd love to see the inside of it. Could I have a look at it?
By all means, come along.
Great.
On a 90-minute training flight, Concorde uses up 23 tons of fuel. The cost of one such flight is over £10,000, and so the candidates for pilot and co-pilot are chosen with the utmost care.
Kit, we've just seen you landing the Concorde now. You've been training today. How does the plane feel?
Well, it feels very nice. It's a very precise aircraft to fly in comparison to the one I flew immediately before this, the VC-10. It's a very smooth, very precise aircraft. It's more demanding in certain phases of the flight, but it's, you know, very capable of meeting those demands.
Mm. Is it easy to handle on takeoff and landing?
Yes, comparatively.
Is it?
I think so.
Mm. Captain Todd, you and I now watched Kit landing. What was your impression of his landing?
Well, I thought from watching it from the outside that he did a very good job. Very difficult to know exactly what he was thinking and doing inside the aeroplane, but from the outside it looked pretty good to me. It wasn't a thumper anyway.
Ah, thank you very much indeed. Excellent.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Well, 10:30 in the morning, in the departure lounge. I saw the very kind gentleman giving me champagne. I don't really want it, but I suppose to further the French wine industry, I really should.
After the champagne reception, more champagne aboard Concorde.
This is undoubtedly the toughest assignment I've ever been on. Frankly, one's initial impression when one gets onto the plane is one of disappointment. You tend to expect something a little more palatial. Mind you, there is extra legroom, and the service is, I understand, second to none. The windows here are smaller than in the normal plane. Originally, the designers didn't want to include windows at all, but it was decided that passengers would demand a view out of the side, and so they were included. The fare, return fare from Dublin to Bahrain, £776. The time will take us 4 hours and 10 minutes in the flight, as distinct from 6 hours and 20 minutes where we're travelling subsonic. So now we're just lining up to take off. About a half an hour, and we've just been handed menus for lunch. Let me give you an idea what's on the menus. Aperitifs, smoked salmon and foie gras canapés. Coming up, we have chilled caviar from Iran. Nowhere else to get caviar from, of course. Then we have a choice of three main courses. Sirloin steak, marchand de vin, breast of duckling and fillets of sole, valeska. It's just like home. Or the RTE canteen.
Our ground speed at the moment is 670 miles per hour. I'd like to welcome on board the Irish Television Company, part of the Mike and Murphy show. Hope they enjoy their flight with us. Thank you very much.
What surprises me is that the cockpit is so small and apparently cramped.
Well, it does look like that because we've got more people than normal due to training going on. And of course, we're right in the very front of a very sharp aircraft. However, the seats are very comfortable and you're only in them for a very short period.
As compared to the subsonic planes.
That's correct, yes.
Thanks very much. Well, at the moment, we're flying at twice the speed of sound. Now, that means we're going at about 23 miles per minute, which is unbelievable. We're traveling faster than the speed of a rifle bullet. It's quite mind-boggling when you think of it.
At that speed, the caviar, a breast of duckling, followed by Stilton cheese and vintage port, teed me up nicely.
In 1964, Tommy Campbell of Fox Rock Golf Club entered the Guinness Book of Records by driving a golf ball 392 yards in Dunleary Golf Club. I am now about to putt a ball at twice the speed of sound. Four seconds that took from the time I struck the ball until it stopped. And travelling at almost half a mile per second, that ball has travelled nearly 2 miles. Tommy Campbell, eat your heart out.